All right, welcome everyone. Waiting for others to join in. So probably we'll wait for a minute. In a minute, we'll start. Okay, which chapter is going on in your school? Can you tell? In your school, what is going on? Started Newton laws of motion. That is in Yashwantpur. In HSR, fluid property is finished. Okay. That is... Okay. So see, what we were doing was system of particles chapter, okay, which is big, right? So I don't want, by the time I finish the center of mass or the system of particles chapter, your school goes ahead in some other dimension, okay? So that's the reason why I have decided that I will take a pause in system of particles chapter, okay? So we will... We have already done one portion of the chapter, that is definition of the system. Okay. So now I'm planning to go to the book number 2 and take mechanical properties of solids and fluids. And after we are done with these two topics and we have caught up with your school, what is happening there, then I'll go back to the system of particles chapter. Okay. So that we are not different from what is happening in your school, right? So this is the new chapter, yes. So do you guys like this idea or you want to continue with system of particles? Something else going on in school and something else here. Semester portions are out. What is the semester portion? What is the portion? And when is the exam? You don't know yet. Okay. All right. Anyways. Okay. So this is a new chapter altogether. And I think some of you have had UTs going on in your school. And it just got over, right? So I can see that some of you might not have completed the homework, or at least you have some excuse that you're not done with the assignment because of UT. Okay. So can you submit today by evening, by end of the day, whichever time you want to take till the night you have time, whatever the assignment that is given to you for this week, can you complete and submit, everyone? I have not seen many submissions this week, probably because of your UT and all. Okay. So I'm assuming you'll be submitting today. Fine. Okay. Take it. All right. So you submitted after the class. Forgot to send. All right. Got the Pranav. Got it. So Pranav, and when is the semester exam, Pranav? September 16th? October, okay. By then we'll be done, don't worry. All right, guys, so let us quickly continue with from where we have left. Now, those who have done the assignment or those who want to, those who will be doing it today, today is the last day, okay? I have extended the deadline. So you can take today's time also because of your UT, you can take a little bit more time. And you will keep on seeing these things. For example, when you do the assignment, you will see that there is a term called radius of gyration. Have you ever encountered it, radius of gyration? Anyone? So if radius of gyration is K for any object, if radius of gyration is K, all right? Yeah, it is there in the assignment. So if the radius of gyration is K with respect to an axis, the moment of inertia will be M into K square. Very simple definition. If radius of gyration is K about one axis, moment of inertia will be M into K square. Okay, so all of you, can you find out K for a disk of radius R? How much it is? It's a uniform disk, uniform mass distribution. If radius is R, what is the radius of gyration for the disk about the natural axis? How much it is? Do you remember moment of inertia for the disk? How much it is? Okay, Pooja got it. Others? What is the formula for moment of inertia for the disk? MR square by 2. This is the formula for moment of inertia. And if radius of gyration is K, this should be equal to M into K square. So from here, you'll get the value of K to be R by root 2. So it's a very simple concept. Fine. So sometimes when you solve numerical, you'll encounter this term radius of gyration, and this is how you deal with it. Okay. So all of you, do you want to take one numerical for the moment of inertia, then start a new chapter or directly start a new chapter? Because I think that some of you might have forgotten because UTs are going on. Okay, take a problem. All right. Fine, let's take a question. Let's take a question on the moment of inertia. Once we are done, we will start a new chapter. And you know, whatever is the integration that is required in physics, it's over now. Okay. So now you will see integration only in the advanced level questions. But till now, whatever integration we have done, integration or calculus, whatever we have done, if you are comfortable with that, you're done with calculus for physics. Okay. So you need to, if you're not comfortable with the calculus in physics, just revise it once again. And you'll become comfortable with it because it calculus is a very repetitive thing. It's not very tricky. You're finding it tricky because you're doing it for the first time. That is the only reason. Okay. So I'm taking a question in which calculus is involved so that even calculus is revised. Okay. So suppose you have a hollow cone. Mechanical properties of solid is a very simple chapter, and you will see that once I start doing it. But before I start, let's do a question on system of particles. That is, which concept? Moment of inertia concept. You need to find moment of inertia about the natural axis. Okay, about this axis. For this cone of mass M, cone radius is R and the height of the cone H, slant height is also given to you L. Everything is given. Slant height is L. From here to here, it is L. Radius is R. Everyone start doing it. moment of inertia about the natural axis you have to find out. This is R, this is L, this is H. Which formula will you use? Moment of inertia will be equal to integral of moment of inertia of a small element dm. Okay. What is the differential element will you take here? Everyone, how that dm will be? What do you think, everyone? Dm mass, how will it look like? Rings. So take a ring like this. Ring has a thickness take a ring of radius small r, okay, radius is small r, take this length, slant length as x. So this thickness of the ring would be dx. Okay. Now for ring, what is the moment of inertia? If mass is dm, moment of inertia for the ring will be how much? Everyone. What will be the moment of inertia? R square dm for ring, right? But the radius you have to take is small r, not the capital R. Radius of the ring square into dm. This is your di, moment of inertia of the ring. This you have to integrate to find out the total moment of inertia. Okay. In order to find that, you need to write dm in terms of dr. Okay. So how will you do that? Mass is distributed in area or volume, everyone. Mass is distributed in the area or volume. It is a hollow cone. Mass is distributed in area. So mass per unit area will be what? M divided by pi r l. This is mass per unit area. Right? Then into, there is no base, it is hollow. Into area of the ring. What should I write area of the ring as, everyone? What it is? Area of the ring. To pi r dr, is this correct? Is this correct? Area of the ring to pi r dr? Everyone? Is this the area of the ring? Pi r dx. Thickness is not dr. Thickness is dx. Thickness is along the slant. Thickness is not along the radius. Got it? That's a big change here. So this is your dm. Okay. So I will cancel out pi from here. I will get it as 2m rl into r into dx. Now the problem is, although you have written m in terms of r, but then dx is also coming in. Okay, can I write dx in terms of dr? Can you write dx in terms of dr? Think over it. Tell me what is dx in terms of dr, or first tell me what is x in terms of r. What is the relation between x and r, everyone? All of you agree that O A B and OCD, they are similar triangles. This triangle is similar to the bigger triangle. All of you agree, right? So I can have a relation between X and R by ratio of the sides. X by R is equal to what? L by capital R. So from here, X is equal to L by R into small r. Everybody understand this? This is X in terms of R. Now when you differentiate it, with respect to R, you'll get dx by dr. It is a trick, it's a common trick. Okay, so first time when you see, you'll be like, oh, something completely different, but then you'll get used to it once you keep on doing it. Dx will be equal to L by R dr. Okay, so just have to substitute here in terms of dx, sorry, in terms of dr, you substitute dx. So you will get dm equals to 2m by rl into r into dx. Now dx I have written in terms of dr. Good thing is l get cancelled, so dm is equal to 2m by r square r dr. Everybody understood how dm is coming? Type in quickly. Any doubts, please type in directly. Everybody understood how this dm is coming? There's a small trick using similarity of triangles. We have to write dx in terms of dr because dx is not dr, it's a separate variable. Getting it? Okay, now substitute this dm over here and get the answer. Integral of r square dm. What is that, Shashwat? 2m by r square r cube dr. Limit for the small r will be what? What should I write limit here? Small r is radius. From where to where it is changing? What to what? 0 to r, all of you? It was 0 at the top, radius of the ring is 0. Then it grew in size and became capital R at the bottom. So 0 to capital R. So what is the answer? Moment of inertia, now tell me the answer. All of you get the answer. So moment of inertia for the hollow cone about the natural axis is mr square by 2. Okay, this. So I hope you have seen how integral is used here properly. You can understand the calculus here. See, I'm not saying that you should be able to solve it, but whatever I have done, you have learned it, right? Whatever I have done here, you have understood it. That is good enough to start with. Okay. Yes, Pranav. Fine. So the homework is you need to find out, the homework is find out the moment of inertia for the solid cone about the natural axis. So that is your homework. So do it after the class. But now we are going to start a new chapter. Very simple chapter it is. It'll get over today itself. Fine. So write down the chapter's name, Mechanical Properties of Solids. Have you seen the index of your book too? Have you seen it? Anyone? So index of book 2, you will see that there are chapters on properties, mechanical properties of solids. Then you have mechanical properties of liquids or fluids. Then you will have thermal properties of matter, right? So you have half of the book, book 2, is about the properties of material. Fine. Now, there are other half of the chapters which are different from the properties of the matter. But my point is that your half of the book is related to properties. Okay. Now, when I talk about property, what does it mean? Let's say property of someone. What all, I mean, how will you describe or what will make you describe property of anything? Let's say property of the pen. What all thing you will talk about it? Everyone? Let's say property of pen. What you can say? Will you say that it can write? If I say property of this pen, if I write down, if I show you 5 pens and if I just take one of the pen and ask you what is the property of this one, will you say that it can write? All 5 can write. Then you'll go to the specifics of it. You'll say it is black. What else? What else you can say? It has certain length. Let's say 10 centimeter length or 20 centimeter length, right? So what are you trying to do? You're getting into something which defines it. Okay, cylindrical, conical arrangement. You will get into very, very specifics of it. You can say that it is made up of a particular type of plastic. You can name the compound. You can go up to that specific. Okay, you can say that the mass of the pen is just 10 grams. Okay, you can say its nib is not very sharp. You can go into very, very specifics of it. So more and more specific you get into, better you are defining it. Okay. So when I say properties of solid, forget about mechanical word. Okay. Forget about that. Let's say properties of solid. What all thing come in your mind? Property of any solid, let's say. I give you a piece of copper and I ask you what is the property of this block. You will say about its mass. You will say that about its density. You will also say that it's a good conductor of heat. You will say it is a good conductor of electricity, right? You will say that if you apply a lot of force on it, then also it doesn't get deformed, right? So all these kind of things you will talk about, okay? But this chapter is about mechanical properties of solids. Now you have probably in your mind, you might be having this kind of property, thermal conductivity. How well it can conduct density. What else? Everyone. Strength. You can say mass. Correct. Volume. Fine. Then you can say ductility. Anything else? Anything else? Malleability. Luminous. Yeah, you can keep on talking about very various things, but then yeah, melting point, very good. Rigidity is covered in ductility, malleability. Okay, melting point, maybe boiling point. Okay. So you will see that some properties are physical properties. For example, if I take a person's name, for example, whom will I take? Chalo, let's talk about Charan, okay? So if I talk about properties of Charan, what will come in your mind? You will be like, okay, Charan's weight is this much. Charan's height is this much. Charan wears this color of the dress. Okay, these are things, they are physical attributes of Charan. These are the physical properties, looks and feel of it. Okay, then someone will say that Charan is a very emotional person. Charan gets happy very easily. Okay, Charan is happy-go-lucky person. Okay, all those things you will try to describe, that will be its different kind of property. Do you agree? One kind of property is different from the other kind of property. Physical properties, one. And then there are these other set of properties which have to do with more of emotional quotient or the mentality and other things. Fine. So there are two different types of property. Do you think one property has to do with the other one? Physical attribute, does it have to do with anything with the mental attributes of anyone? No, right? They are two different things. Fine. So the laws which govern the physical attributes are different from the laws which governs the mental attributes of a person. Okay, you can exercise and become very strong. So you physically may be very strong, but mentally may be very weak. Okay, so there are different kinds of, you may have to do meditation to become stronger mentally. So what I'm trying to say is that different rules govern different kinds of property. That is the reason why you have mechanical properties separate from thermal properties. The rules which govern the thermal property of matter is different from the rules that govern the mechanical properties of matter. Okay. And in mechanical properties specifically, mechanical properties of solid follow one set of rule. Mechanical properties of liquids and gas, they follow different set of rules. So that is the reason why you don't have mechanical properties of solids and liquids together in a single chapter. But when it comes to thermal properties, you have a single chapter. It is not thermal properties of solids, then thermal properties of fluids. It is a thermal properties of matter, everything together, because rules are same. But here rules are different. So that's why mechanical properties of solid is different and liquid it is different. Now when I say mechanical properties, what all things are there out of this? Strength is there, mass is there, density, volume, ductility, and malleability. Fine. These kind of attributes we are going to learn in this chapter. Right? These are the mechanical properties of the solids. All right. Now, can anyone tell me why we are studying mechanical properties of solids? Why there is a need to study it at all? Anyone? Why you want to understand the behavior of solids? That is what I'm asking. So I'm asking why you're learning mechanical properties of solid. Answer is to learn the mechanical properties of solids. As in, what is the usefulness? Where you use it? I'm not taking names, anybody's name. Tell me. Correct. So you look around yourself, all the structures. If you talk about homes, solids. You talk about the motorbikes, you talk about the fan, you talk about the bag, books, everything. You look around yourself, everything is solid. Okay. And understanding the strength is very important. Understanding how solid will behave when you apply a force on it is very, very important. You don't want your building to crumble under the pressure. So that is why you might have not seen it, But nowadays, metro construction is going on. It'll go on forever for next 10, 15 years. But whenever they are constructing the metro station, do you know they do soil testing? They check whether the soil is good enough for the metro bridge to be constructed there. Because even the property, mechanical properties of soil is very important. Do you know that a lake, when it is dried, you cannot construct a high story building on the dried lake because the soil which is of the dried lake is not conducive for it. Your infrastructure may fall. Okay, so soil testing is very important to understand the mechanical properties. And also, when you construct the bridges or when you construct the building, you might have seen in your basement there are a lot of pillars. Like if you're staying in a flat, you will see that on a basement the entire building is stood on a lot of pillars. Now one can say that I don't need to calculate the strength of anything. I will have my many pillars. I'll have 100 pillars, so I'll be safe. No problem with it. Okay, but the disadvantage will be that guy will end up spending a lot of money. Every pillar you stand, probably you may have to shell out a lot of money. So if you're playing very, very safe without even calculating, you may have to spend a lot of money. So you might have seen the bridges. Every now and then there is a pillar. So if you don't, let's say, calculate after what distance you should put a pillar, then you'll play safe. And after every 2-3 meters, you'll construct a pillar. So imagine the kind of wastage you'll have. A lot of money will go for waste. So it makes sense to understand the strength of the material and understand how every material will behave when a force or a pressure is applied on it, so that you can make an informed decision. That okay, fine, I'll be safe if I have only this much thickness of the pillar and I'll put after every 10 meters, it is fine. So I'll not unnecessarily waste the material. Okay, so strength of material study is very, very important. So there's a reason why inside the pillar there are iron rods. You're aware of it, right? Iron rods they put inside the pillars. Okay, there's a reason to it. The simple reason is that the concrete, the cement, can take lot of load, lot of pressure it can take if you have pressure like this, if you compress it. But as soon as there's a force or there's a pressure which tries to expand it, the cement will break apart. It is so brittle. That is the reason why you put the iron rod in between so that it can support not only the compression but extension also. So there is a reason for each and everything that is done. Okay, so that's the reason why we are studying this chapter. It is a very, very important chapter. If you are aiming to go for, I mean, if you want to become an architect or a civil engineer, anybody here who is aiming to become an architect here? Okay, there is at least one. So for you, it is very, very important. Do you know that if you take these civil engineering courses or architectural courses, you will be studying for 1 or 2 years only this chapter? Right now, this chapter is very, very small, just basic introduction of it. It is there in class 11th. But if you go for engineering, same chapter, you'll have to, it will become this much thick book. Okay, you have to study quite a lot and detail how everything behaves. Okay, one solid might behave in a dry condition in one way it will behave, but same solid probably in a moist situation will be different behavior. Okay, so very, very important these factors are. Okay, so that's why we are studying it. So all of you, I think I have answered why we are studying this chapter. Okay. So just give me a second. So first of all, one thing you need to understand that every solid gets deformed. If we apply force or pressure, whatever it is, we are going to discuss it. If you are applying a force on a solid, it will get deformed. Deformation may be negligible. You may not be able to feel it or see it, but it is there. Okay. But why don't, you know, if let's say very, very small deformation is there, if every day I apply the force, after 10 days, deformation should be visible to us. Then why it is not visible? What do you think is happening? Little, little deformation should happen every day, and then you'll be able to see it every time you apply force on something. Even if you are while opening the laptop also, small deformation should happen. After let's say 100 days, deformation should be visible that, oh yes, this is the total deformation which is visible to us. Correct. It goes back to its original shape and size. Okay. Whatever small deformation it has, it immediately, as soon as you stop applying the force or effort, it goes back to its original shape. What is this called? This behavior of going back to its original shape? Elasticity. This is called elasticity. Okay. So rubber band is more elastic or this pen is more elastic? What do you think? Okay, some of you are saying rubber band, some of you are saying pen. The answer is pen is more elastic. Because the way you're defining elasticity, you're saying rubber band because deformation is higher and it is still able to go back. But elasticity is not defined like that. Definition of elasticity is, write down, write down tendency of an object to go back to its original shape and size. Okay. Now this tendency is more for the pen than a rubber band. How is that? I can apply 100 Newton on this pen. Deformation I'm not able to see, but it is there. And then it still goes back to its original shape. But if I apply 100 Newton on a rubber band, it'll break. It won't be able to go back. It's gone. Fine. So tendency is like how much an object wants to go back, how much effort it applies to go back to its original shape, which is of course more for the pen, right? So this is called elasticity. Okay. There is one more term called plasticity. Write down. Write down plasticity. So plasticity is referred as permanent deformation. Have you ever seen that you apply a force on something and the solid is permanently deformed? Example, any example? Clay, it is written in your textbook, clay. What else? Spring sometimes. Sometimes spring, if you stretch the spring too much, will it be able to go back? No. Paper is, it breaks very easily, right? Folding paper wire if you stretch. Okay, and have you ever stretched a polythene like this? Have you ever stretched a polythene? So when you stretch it, does it go back? When you stretch it, let's say a little bit, it doesn't go back. Permanent deformation. So plasticity is, plastic is the best example of plasticity. Fine. The name comes from there. All right. So these are the two behaviors, and we are going to study in this chapter, we are going to study the elasticity. Of solid elasticity only. Okay, if you talk about mechanical properties of solid, it is huge. Okay, you need to discuss that if I have, let's say, 50% moisture in the air, then how it will behave. If I if let's say at this temperature, this is the mechanical property, at some other temperature, some other mechanical property, it is endless. But in class 11th, only study of elasticity is there. Okay. So we are going to see that how the elastic behavior is shown by the object. Now, before getting into the elastic behavior of an object, we need to first understand what deforms the object. What is the cause? Cause of deformation. Is it the force? Cause of deformation of solids. Okay, in order to study that, just take a simple experiment. Okay, I'm going to draw it here. See, all of this comes with the experience. It is not that it should be this and it should be that. We have observed that this is true. That is why it is true. Suppose you take two wooden planks like this. Okay. You have two wooden planks. And have you seen the pencil heels? Pencil heels, have you seen? Not many. Let's say this is the pencil heel, of course, of some lady, and let's say the mass of that person is 60 kg. So I am assuming that someone who is wearing pencil heel is lighter. So 60 kg. Okay. This is a wood. This is also wooden block. Both are same. Here the lady is standing on her one leg. Okay. And over here, one elephant is standing on his one leg. Elephant weight is couple of 1,000 kgs. Okay. Now, where do you think solid will be getting deformed? This case or that case? Case number one or case number two? Both. More chances, more chance. Chance is what? Suppose it happens only one, in only one. Which one? Suppose wood is placed on the horizontal floor. Then the first one. Right? It is the first one. Where do you think force is applied more? Force on the wood, which one is more? Case number two, force is more. Both of them are applying mg force. Here mg and here also mg only. But small m is the mass of the lady, which is very less. Capital M is mass of the elephant, very large. But suppose you have doubt that I don't know which one will get deformed. Then what lady does, she stands on the pencil heel only and take a turn like that. Then there will not be any doubt. There will be a ditch here created like that. Okay, so definitely here it will get deformed, but you can see the force is way lesser than the force over there. So it is not force that is deforming the solid. If you look at these two cases, here what is more is force per unit area. Okay, so this is something which is the cause of deformation. Write down. So if it breaks, it's due to how densely the force is applied, as in force per unit area. Okay, nothing else. Everybody understood this thing? Okay, fine. So now we know what is the cause. All right, but the problem is still the solid can get deformed in multiple different ways. Solids, write down, can be deformed in many ways. So we need to discuss one by one how many ways it is getting deformed and what are the laws which govern all that. Okay. Am I going very slow? Very, very slow. Okay, suppose you have a cube like this. Draw a cube like this. This is a piece of solid. All right. Now, talking about the deformation of this solid cube, in what ways you can deform it? You can apply force from here and there. It'll get deformed. Right, this is one way of deforming it. You can apply force from two opposite sides and it get deformed. These two opposite sides can be any two opposite sides, can be top and bottom, can be sideways, this side or that side. Getting it? So this is one of the ways. Can you think of any other way of deforming this solid, everyone? Same but in opposite direction. Okay, good. So you can apply the compression like this. And it turns out that if you talk about the elastic solid, then both ways it is same only, whether you apply compression or the extension. Okay. Another proper way of deforming it, keeping the base fixed. See here, the force is perpendicular to the face. Force is perpendicular to the face. Okay. Another way is you can have a force. Can I have force parallel to the face? Can that happen, which will create deformation? Anyone? Parallel to the face? No, there is a way. You can keep the bottom face fixed. Okay, this bottom face, if you fix it and you apply a force like that, parallel to this face. Okay, like this. If you apply the force, the face will shift forwards. Everyone getting this? You have a pen like this, you're pushing it like that. Rather than stretching it, you're pushing it like that. Everyone understood? Okay, so correct. So this phase will be shifting little bit forward. Okay, so this is what will be seen. It will shift that way. So this deformation is different. Point number one, the force is parallel to the face. And second point is the angle between the two vertices is not 90 anymore. Okay. These are two deformation. Another very common deformation is this one. Rather than force from two sides or one side, you can have the force from all sides. Okay, it is very common. Inside the fluid. So you will learn that fluid has a special property that it can apply pressure, same pressure in all direction. So if an object is inside the fluid, it can get compressed from all the sides. Okay. So when you put a solid under a lot of pressure, then how it behaves, even that we are going to study it. Fine. Now, of course, many other things will come in your mind that what will happen if I rotate this? What will happen if I do something else? Okay. The answer to those questions is that these are the three ideal ways you can deform the solid. And when solid gets deformed, everything can happen together also. Same solid has force like this, like that, and it's getting crushed also. All three together. Okay, but when we are studying it, we can't study all of them together. We'll be studying it one by one. And then even if all of them are together happening, then I can apply all the laws which I have learned together. But while learning, we'll have to study one by one. Okay. Everyone understood, right? Fine. Now talking about the heart of the chapter, as in the most basic thing about the chapter is about stress and strain. Okay, tell me if you know what is stress already. What is it? What is stress? Not your mental stress for the physics. What it is? Okay, force per unit area, pressure. Okay, so you are telling me stress is what force you apply divided by the area. Is that what you're saying? What force you apply divided by the area. Okay. Understood. Fine. Although that's not entirely correct, we'll discuss it. Right now, all of you write down that what we are trying to do here is that we are trying to find out what is the action, as in what causes deformation, and what is the reaction? What and how to quantify deformation? You know, it is one way of saying that, okay, fine, this person runs faster, that person runs even faster, and this one runs slower. Okay, so unless I tell that what is the velocity, all these discussions are meaningless. If I say that, a lot of deformation will happen. It will not give you, you know, sense of satisfaction, or you will not understand what it is till you put a number to it till you're like, okay, fine, the deformation is 0.001. 001 should mean something. Okay, so we have to quantify what is the deformation. Okay, we need to also quantify what is the cause of the deformation. We have little bit touched upon it when we discussed the two example, elephant and the lady one. Okay, but over here, small thing is that the stress, which is the cause of the resistance, sorry, cause of the deformation, is not what you apply divided by area. What it is the force of resistance. Force of resistance, which material applies on you. It is a pair force divided by the area. Will force of resistance be always equal to whatever force you are applying? Tell me. Force of resistance, is it the it is the pair force of what you are applying. Will it be always equal to what force you are applying? Force of resistance. It seems like what force I am applying, whatever force I am applying, the material will apply equal and opposite force on me. And that is a reaction force. Force of resistance is a reaction to my action. So ideally they should be equal. And most of the time they are equal also. Okay. Most of the time, force of resistance is equal to the applied force. Now I'll talk about one example, which those who have played with stretching the membrane or stretching the polythene for no reason, they'll understand more. So when you stretch the polythene, just before polythene breaks, do you feel that suddenly polythene has stopped applying resistance, or the resistance has dropped suddenly for a large amount? Have you felt that? Right? You felt it? Just before the polythene breaks, Pranav, that kind of nonsense, okay, don't tell. Okay, you have to keep it formal. I'm not here to listen to all that loser kind of thing. Those who have, you're telling that those who have done this experiment, they're losers. You mean that? Don't use those kind of words, okay? So when you stretch it, when you stretch the polythene, it is about to break, the polythene suddenly stop applying the resistance force. Okay, so it is not that the resistance is always equal to what force you apply. Getting it? If an object is weak, for example, this chair will be able to apply whatever force I am applying till whatever strength it has. If I apply 1,000,000 newton on this chair, chair will break. Okay, so chair will not feel the force, whatever I am applying. Chair will feel the force only till the point it is resisting it. Okay, so it is a force of resistance which is the cause. If you're talking about a weak material which cannot even feel the amount of force which you are applying before that itself it breaks, then no point talking about that force. You have to talk about only that force which the material can feel, and it will feel only till the point it is not getting broken apart. Okay. Yeah, the Newton law, third law of motion, is still valid, because if you apply large amount of force, let's say you have a sponge, if you apply 1,000,000 newton on it, it'll break. Immediately it will break, but it will create acceleration. So force equal to mass m acceleration. When net force is zero, then it will have equal and opposite this thing. Yes, Aditya, all that we'll discuss. Hold on. So all of you understand, stress is force of resistance divided by area. Okay. then this is the cause of the deformation. And there is this word strain that quantifies the deformation, amount of deformation, the way we quantify it, this is called the strain. Fine. Now, initially itself, we discussed that there are different ways solids can get deformed. So we need to take one by one these ways and understand what is the stress, what kind of stress the object has, and how to define the strain for that particular scenario. Okay. So first thing that we are going to learn here is longitudinal stress and strain. Write it down. So longitudinal stress and strain is a first kind of stress and strain. What is that? Wherein, let's say you have an object, this object you have, okay, a thick wire, fine. You are applying force on it like that. Equal and opposite force, suppose you are applying. Fine, this wire doesn't break. So the resistance force will also be equal to whatever force you are applying. Force F and force F. Okay, just so that you know the resistance force, because you'll be dealing with wires a lot in this chapter. Resistance force, I should write that in the previous slide. Resistance force in a wire is which force? Any guesses? Which force is resistance? Guess? Yes, it is tension. Good. So if you have any confusion, what force should I use to create, to find out the stress, get the value of tension. Tension is the resistance force. Okay. All right. And most of the time tension will be equal to whatever force it is getting applied on it. Okay. So let's say it is a uniform wire of length L. The area is A. Okay, what else should be given? That's it. Okay, so when you're applying the force, what is observed is that this wire get stretched a bit. Okay, this much amount of stretching won't be there, but just to, you know, clearly show I have increased the length substantially. So when you are applying this stretching force F, L has become L plus delta L, and delta L is very small. So I'm assuming area is not changed, but in fact, area also changes when you stretch it. Okay. The assumption is delta L is very small. So area doesn't change. Fine. Now all of you, the stress over here is called longitudinal stress, sigma L. What do you think this is equal to, everyone? This is a symbol for the stress, sigma. What it is equal to? Sigma L is equal to what? Resistance force is F only. Force divided by area. Everybody understood this? Everyone type it. Is it clear? Now over here, you are talking about the perpendicular component of the force, perpendicular to the surface, that divided by area. Okay, this is sigma L. This is the cause of the deformation. Cause. Now, what is the effect? Deformation is how much? Suppose I have to quantify deformation. What should I write? Everyone, what should be the deformation? Delta L. Okay, that's an obvious choice. Everyone, is it delta L? Cross section area you have to take. This is area of cross section. Okay, A is the area of the cross section. Suppose I have to quantify deformation. What should I write here? Is delta L sufficient? Everyone? Okay, all right. Okay. What if you have a wire of double the length and same amount of force is applied, stress is same, that delta L will be same or different? What do you think? Delta L will be same or different? If length changes, delta L will change or will remain same? Area is same. Will the delta L change or remain same? Everyone, answer it. It will change. If it is double, delta L will become double. Okay? Got it? So, you can imagine, like, take a smaller spring, take a bigger spring. If you stretch the bigger spring, it will stretch more for the same amount of force. Okay? Or if you have any confusion, assume this double length as if it has two lengths, two rods of this is, what I'm saying, a single bigger rod is made up of two smaller rods. Every part will have delta L deformation. So total deformation is delta L. Like that you can think. So delta L cannot be the effect of the cause. So deformation can't be delta L. Why it cannot be delta L? If deformation is defined as delta L, then for every time if I apply this cause of deformation, which is sigma L, longitudinal stress, it should give me the same deformation. But if I define deformation as delta L, for the same force per unit area, I am getting different delta L. So this is not proper definition. Then I have to check, okay, fine, what is the length and all, everything I have to take care of. So the effect, this is the cause, the effect of the stress is strain, and we are talking about the longitudinal strain, which is written as epsilon L. Okay, epsilon L is a longitudinal strain. This is equal to delta L by L. Deformation per unit length. This will remain same no matter what length of the wire you take. So this is a better variable to deal with than just delta L. Everyone understand this? I think it's very simple chapter. A is the cross section area. A is the cross section area. Everyone, A is the cross section area. Okay. This is the cause. Longitudinal stress is cause. Longitudinal strain is the effect. Now, can you tell me if I have this kind of cylinder? I have this kind of cylinder. The radii are, this is R1 and the bigger radius is R2. There is a cavity inside the cylinder, a cylindrical cavity inside a solid cylinder. Then if I apply force like that, what will be my stress? How to write down the value of stress over here, longitudinal stress? Everyone, try it. Do you understand the question? What is the longitudinal stress over here? Okay, Aditya got it. Others? Hey Arnav, you haven't corrected your thing. You can still type. Okay, Pooja got it. Others? No, 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 you guys are making one silly error. Okay, Pranav got something. Himanshu and Pooja, check what you have done. Arnav is gone, not. Arnav is gone, then. Pranav is also gone, is it? Okay. Sigma L is what? Force divided by area. Which area you have to take now? You have to take area of the material. R2 square minus R1 square. Pi R2 square minus pi R1 square. Everybody understand this? Okay. All right. So talking about these kind of, we have discussed the cause, which is stress, and the effect, which is the strain. It is like, you remember Newton's second law, force is equal to mass times acceleration. Force is the cause, acceleration is the effect. So you have an equation between force and acceleration, between cause and the effect. There is a relation. Similarly, here also, we are trying to find out a relation between cause, which is the stress, and the effect, which is a strain. Okay, that relation, you can't derive it like, some formula or things. You need to have some experiment or observations based on which you can find out what could be the relation. Okay, for example, if we take a typical solid for which I can draw stress strain curve. Write down. So we will try to observe the stress strain curve for an object. And let's see, is there a relation, correlation between stress and strain? That is the best way to see. Okay. So all of you draw. This is the very important part of the chapter. So everyone should understand it properly. So let's say this is sigma and this is epsilon. Okay. So there is this experimental setup in which what they do is that they have a machine. When you go to some college, you'll see this experiment. If you take mechanical or civil, you'll have this experiment in which there's a clamp which holds the steel or iron bar from top and above. And then that clamp stretches the iron bar from both sides. Okay. When it stretches it, the iron bar length changes. So every time its length changes a little bit, the force of resistance, which is equal to whatever force you're applying, because acceleration is zero. Slowly, slowly it moves up. So you'll measure the resistance force, what is being applied, and you will also see the strain. So automatically that machine will record everything and plot a graph. Fine. So when a lot of materials are used in this experiment, a typical kind of curve is observed. Okay, the shape of the curve remains similar. And this is how it looks like, what we are going to draw here. Okay. So first of all, you will see a straight line like that. Up to some point, you'll see a straight line. And then it bends little bit like this, goes like that, and dips down. This is the typical graph which is observed. All right. So if I name critical points over here, let me name it. This is zero. This is point A, up to which it remains linear. I'll talk about what is this point B is. C is a random point. Okay. I'll put this D at the peak. D is the topmost point. And this is where the material breaks. This is where the fracture happens. This is fracture point. All of you draw this. Fracture point. Okay. Now this D2, let's say this is E. D2E is the same thing, which the example you've taken, right? For polythene, when you're stretching it, it breaks. Before breaking, it the stress is reduced. Stress is a resistance force, so it gets reduced from maximum to the point where it breaks, fine? So the observation of the graph is that O to A is a straight line. Okay, O to A is a straight line. And in the straight line, can I say sigma is proportional to epsilon? Can I say this, everyone? Can I say that sigma is proportional to epsilon, everyone? Do I have to ask very specially to some people, those who choose not to say anything? I'm asking something, all of you reply. Can I say sigma is proportional to epsilon? Everyone reply. Right, I can say that, and this behavior is a, you can say this point A is proportionality limit. Up to point A, it is proportional. And yes, it will be different for the slope of this line is different for different material. Okay, slope is this tan of theta, you can say. This slope is different for different material. Now, can you tell me for the slope is more for, let's say, iron or rubber? Which one slope is more? Theta is more for iron or for the rubber? Rubber, iron. It is iron only, right? For large amount of stress also I am getting lesser deformation. So deformation of iron will be lesser, no? So that is how it is. So if a material is rigid, its slope will be very high. Okay. Anyways, so A is a proportionality limit. Then this point up to point A, if you have a stress and you leave it, it will go back to here. When you're taking it to point A and then leaving it, then what will happen? The stress will become zero. Okay. Stress becomes zero. So it will be anywhere along this x-axis. And if it comes here, what does it mean? If I release it and the point comes here, it means what? Everyone? This is a point for which stress is zero, where I have left the object. I have reached here, then I leave it, it comes here, suppose. This point means what? Zero stress. But what about strain? Is deformation is there? Deformation still there. Okay. This is called permanent deformation. Correct. Correct. Okay. So till point A, it is proportional. And if you leave it, then it again goes back to this origin point only, where zero stress, zero strain. And that behavior extended till B also. Okay. So till A, though it is proportional, but till B, if you release from B also, you know, between A to B, it is not a straight line. So between A to B, stress is not proportional to strain. Okay. But then if you release at B also, then also it will come back. Zero stress, zero strain. But if you go beyond B, okay, if you go beyond B, let's say point number C, after that point, it will have a permanent deformation. It can maybe, you know, if even if you release it after point B, if you go and then if you release it, then also there will be some permanent deformation. Okay, the plastic behavior will start from there, from B. All right, so B, there is a name to it. This is called the yield point. Okay, this is the yield point. Everyone, till this point, if you release it, sigma, if it becomes zero, epsilon can also become zero. Beyond that, it will not become zero. Fine. And then there is one more critical point, D. What does that represent? Can anybody guess? What should this be representing? This point is represent. Any name that comes in your mind, what do you think it should represent? Maximum strength or the strength of the material, right? So this is our ultimate strength, whatever you may want to call it. Okay. So technical term is tensile strength, because we are talking about longitudinal here, right? Tensile strength. How much tension it can take. Okay. This is the thing here. Got it? So this is the stress strain curve. Any doubts here? Anyone has any doubt? Quickly type in, else I'll move on to the next. Anyone has any doubt? Huh, waiting, Himanshu. Why isn't E the tensile point? Because it should represent strength. Strength is represented by how much maximum you can take, right? How much maximum, is not that point. After C, it will have permanent deformation. D is a maximum strength. So why do you think that is contradictory? Tensile strength would be D. Yes. D is a tensile strength. After D, it will not break. It will still go till E and then break. If the object takes some time to come back after sigma is equal to zero, is it still plasticity? Takes some time to come back. No, it is not plasticity. You waited long enough. The time factor is not there. Okay. You can wait for long enough time. If it comes back, then it is elasticity. Okay. Position C does not occur. Okay. Fine. All right. No, I'm not saying that exact same graph you will get every time. But this is a typical graph I'm saying. Distance between A and B could be lesser, could be more. Distance between B and D could be lesser or more. But this is the typical graph. Every time, one thing you'll see that a solid material, there will be a portion wherein stress is proportional to strain. And in our chapter, in class 11th, we are going to work only between 0 to A, okay? Where stress is proportional to strain. We are not going beyond A. Otherwise, chapter will become huge. Fine. So we are only learning in this chapter about the proportionality, up to the proportionality limit, not beyond that. Okay. Now, this is a typical graph, but doesn't mean that every material on earth should have the same graph. Okay. So there are, there are objects which have different kind of graphs also. For example, if I, do you know this tissue which is there on the heart? Aorta, have you heard of? Have you heard of aorta? Anybody taken bio? Right, in the heart. So you might know that it expands and contract so many times in a day. So this is probably the one object which gets deformed, comes back to original shape, again goes back, comes back. So multiple times it does. So this is amazing, right? And the stress strain curve for this one. Yes, Madhav. You will learn when you go to grade 11, Madhav. So this is the curve you will see. Getting it? This is nowhere like what typical solid material or metals that we deal with. Okay. So although this is typical, but don't assume that it will be always there like that. Now that we have observed how things are, let's talk about a law here, which will give us some sort of equation so that we solve some numerical, right? Till now, it is all theoretical stuff. Do you like theoretical chapters like these or the numerical types chapter? Which one do you prefer? Numericals. NLM. Newton laws of motion is that kind of chapter. You spend your entire life still. There will be few questions you will not be. Once you're done with the advanced level NLM, let me know. I'll give you a couple of questions of some other level. Okay. But a lot of time is there till you reach there. So keep on practicing. Hooke's law. Hooke's law is a law which came before this observation, you know. Before this graph, people knew Hooke's came with a law. And what was that law? Hooke's told that stress is proportional to strain. Okay, and this is how it is between 0 to A, proportionality limit. Okay, and this is of course valid for a linear zone. Between 0 to A, okay. So for a particular solid material, stress is equal to some constant Y times strain. Anybody has seen this constant Y before? What is this Y? It's a constant proportionality between stress and strain in the case of longitudinal. Okay, good. You guys know it. Probably, yeah, you have done this chapter, right, in school. Y is the Young's modulus. Okay. It is constant for a material. Does not depend upon, write down, doesn't depend upon the geometry. Whether you take this thin wire, thick wire, cube, whatever shape and size you take, Young's modulus is going to be constant. And it's a, you know, great, great tool, because Young's modulus is nothing but a ratio between stress and strain. Every time, for all the cases you find out the stress, for all the cases you find out the strain, take the ratio between stress and strain, it will be constant. What is the unit of Young's modulus, everyone? What do you think is the unit? Newton per meter square? Does Pascal come in your mind? Pascal? Is Pascal the unit of the Young's modulus? Can I say that? No, you cannot say Pascal. Pascal is a unit of pressure. Okay, Pascal is a unit of pressure. You cannot say that it is, although dimensionally they are equal. Dimensionally, the unit of work done is equal to the unit of torque. But work done and torque, they are not same, right? So you should not say joules for the torque. Okay. So if there is a wire, if there is a wire like this of cross-section area A, and you're applying force like this. Area of cross-section is A. The length is L, it undergoes deformation of delta L. Can you quickly tell me what is the expression of Y? All of you, do it first. Stress is this. Strain is. Correct. Is true for a wire like this. Hmm. And whatever we have done, this thing is valid not only for the stretching, but also for the compressing. Young's modulus will be same. All right. Young's modulus is typically of the order of, for metals, of the order of 10 raised to the power 5. Okay. So this is the theory of the Young's modulus, the longitudinal stress and longitudinal strain. Let us take numericals on it. We'll be taking up some school level thing, then couple of advanced level, so that you don't take the chapter for granted. There are some small details in the numericals. Okay. So I'll first take the school level things. Best thing is to take the NCERT book. Part 2, right? Part 2. This is Hooke's. Looks like Newton. These are not their real hairs, you know. They should show their head size bigger. Rather than that, they're showing their hair size bigger. Do this, all of you. What is the answer? A, B, C, D, A, B, C. Three parts are there. For the first part, what is the answer? No one got the answer of part A. That is strange. How much? Quickly answer. Okay, different answers people are getting for part A. Vibhav is correct. Only Vibhav got it. If you think that you are beyond this simple question, let me tell you, you'll suffer in the exam, okay? You will see the kind of failures you'll make in the exam. Give respect to every question. If it is simple, you have to give more respect. Solve it properly. Okay, Aditya got it correct. Others, simply you have to do force per unit area, which is the stress, force divided by area of cross section. Okay, force is how much? 100 kilonewton force. 100 kilonewton is 100 into 1000 divided by area. Area is pi r square, which is 10 mm. 10 mm is 10 to the minus 2. So 10 to the power minus 4 it comes. Okay. So this is 10 by pi into 10 to the power 8. And you should remember pi square is roughly 10. Okay, so 10 by pi is 3.14. 3.14 into 10 to the power 8 newton per meter square. This is your stress. Okay, B part. Elongation. How much elongation it has? Yes, elongation is delta L. How much it is? Okay. Others, quickly answer. Okay, done. Fine. So stress by strain is Young's modulus, which is 2 into 10 to the power 11. So from here, strain is stress divided by the Young's modulus. So strain is 3.14 into 10 to the power 8 divided by 2 into 10 to the power 11. Okay. So this is 1.57 roughly 10 to the power minus 3. Epsilon is delta L by L. L is 1 meter. So delta L by 1 is this. So delta L is that only. This. Okay. C part, what is the answer for C? Strain is how much? What is the unit for strain? What it is? Unit for strain is what? No units. Okay? No units. So delta L you should write in meters, and delta L by L, when they are asking you strain, this is dimensionless. You just need to write like this, 1.57 into 10 to the power minus 3. The best way to write this is in terms of percentage. You can say 0.157% is the deformation. Okay. Fine. So this is one of those simple direct formula based question. Let's take up another one from your textbook only. This one is better. See, here, let me tell you a few things. Copper wire, let's say length is L1. Let me draw the diagram, you know, then I'll represent it. So hold on for some time. Let me draw it and then you attempt it. This is copper. This one is, let's say, steel. Okay. You are applying force here and there is force F. For copper, length is L1. For copper, Young's modulus is Y1. Area of cross-section is same for both, so A only. This is L2 and Y2 for steel, and this is A. You don't need to substitute the values. No need to calculate anything. In terms of this, you need to find out what is the value of F. And yes, total elongation is given, delta L. Don't substitute the values right now. Find out. What is the problem you guys are facing here? You're not able to proceed, then what is the problem you're facing? Tell me. Where you guys are stuck? Where are you stuck? What is the problem? The main problem over here is that there are different materials, isn't it? There is no single Young's modulus for entire rod. Then how will you do this? If there are different materials, then what do you do? Any ideas? Average, division, yes, you divide it. You break the rod into two parts. One, take copper, draw its free body diagram. Take steel, draw its free body diagram. That's how you start, okay? So how much force, let's say I'm drawing for copper. This is L1, Y1. I know this side is F. What is this force? How much should be this force? This one is how much? Who is applying this force? Steel is applying. How much it should be? How much force steel applies on the copper? Don't know. Copper is at rest. So net force should be zero. So it should be F only. It is at rest. Net force should be zero. That's the reason why. Steel. Action reaction pair. F here, F there. Okay. Now what should I do? Everyone, this is taken from your book only, textbook. Are you finding it very difficult, everyone? Very difficult to you? What should I do next? Tell me the answer now. Are you done? Those who are answering what to do, are you done? What, suppose delta L1 is the extension over here, delta L2 is extension over there. What is the relation among delta L's? What should I write? Can I say delta L1 plus delta L2 is equal to delta L? All of you agree? Right? It will be this. Delta L1 in this case, how much it will be? 180 Newton. What is 180? Oh, answer, you're telling me 180. You know, answer is there in the book also. I don't care about that at all. I am asking here something else. You're telling something else. So delta L1 plus delta L2 is delta L, right? Delta L1, how will you get? What is delta L1? Everyone answer. Delta L1 is what? Namrata, what it is? Delta L1. They haven't given Y1, Y2. It'll be given, don't worry. In the question, in your book, Y1, Y2 will be given at the back side. Don't worry about it. So F L by A delta L, this was equal to Young's modulus, right? So delta L1 will be equal to F L1 divided by A Y1 plus delta L2 is F L2 by A Y2. This is equal to delta L. Okay. You can take F common. F by A, you can take common. You'll have L1 by Y1 plus L2 by Y2 is equal to delta L. So from here, you just separate the terms, you'll get the answer for F. Cross multiply. Y1, Y2 will be given to you, don't worry. Okay, it'll be given. Everybody understood this? Type in quickly, then I can move to next. These are your school level questions. Clear? Okay, let us see little bit of calculus. Okay, now not calculus, so we'll take this one. This question calculus will take up after the break, this question, but you can do it without calculus. Suppose you have a rod like this, okay? You are applying a force over here. No, calculus is utilized here also. Sorry, calculus can't leave you. Chalo, then do this one. Little bit of calculus is there, don't worry about it. The moment I say calculus, suppose you are applying force F from the end. There is this rod, massless rod, okay? It has no mass. You're pulling the rod down by a force of F, okay? It has length L, Young's modulus Y, and cross section area A. Getting it? Now, I'll write here negligible mass. Achha, tell me one thing. When I apply the force, am I doing work on the rod or not? Everyone, when I'm applying the force, am I doing the work? Yes or no? When I'm pulling the rod down, rod is moving. Delta L is a displacement, right? So I'm doing work. Whichever direction, whichever point I am pulling down, it is moving. So there's a displacement. There's a force, there's a displacement. So work done is there. What is happening to this work done? According to the work-energy theorem, suppose it gets deformed and then stops. Whatever work I have done, where it goes? Potential energy. Are you getting it? Getting it? So you need to find work done by the force. In this case, and that is also equal to potential energy, change in potential energy, or potential energy stored inside this rod. Find out, everyone. Let us see if you can do it your own. It will be very nice. Have you done this in your school? Finding potential energy stored in the rod? Okay. Find out. Work done is the potential energy. Is it a constant force? If it is a constant force, simply F into delta L you can do. But is it a constant force? If it is slowly and slowly moving down, it's not a constant force. So you want to try yourself or should I do it? Should I give you some time? Okay, try it. I'm giving you 1 minute, 1 or 2 minutes. The moment you are stuck, let me know. I'm giving you a hint. Assume the rod is extended by X. Rod is extended by a X amount. Find out force in terms of X and then integrate F dx. You'll get the answer. Now should I do it? Is stuck or able to proceed? 30 seconds. No Himanshu, that's not correct. Okay, all of you, if rod is extended by X, what is the value of force, everyone, in terms of Young's modulus and everything? No, not that, Pranav. What is the value of force if it is extended by X? By FL by A delta L, which is X, is Young's modulus. So the force is AY by L times X. This is the force, right? So this force I have to integrate. This force is not a constant force. So work done is equal to integral of f dx, x goes from 0 to delta L. Okay, so work done is equal to Ay by L is constant, comes outside, integral of x dx, 0 to delta L. So work done is Ay delta L square by 2L. Everyone understand this? That's it. This is the work done and this is the potential energy stored in the rod. Everybody understood this? Okay, now tell me how to write this formula for the work done or the potential energy in terms of stress and strain. I don't want Young's modulus in it. I want in the formula only stress and strain. Can you modify this formula and tell me what it is? Total extension in the rod is delta L. Find out, can you modify this formula in terms of stress and strain? Anyone getting it? Write down in terms of stress and strain. Sigma is stress, which is F by A. Epsilon is strain, that is delta L by L. Right? Young's modulus can be written as sigma delta L by L. So sigma is Young's modulus delta L by L. So you can play around with this and modify this in terms of stress and strain, what you can write. Okay, let me do it. Potential energy stored, which is the work done, can be written as Young's modulus delta L by L into delta L by 2L multiplied by A into L. Okay, and you see that we can write like this, everyone? Everyone, can you see that? We can write like that. This sigma into epsilon by 2. A into L is what? What do you think A into L is? Volume. So potential energy stored is half of stress into strain into volume. Okay. And density of potential energy. Density of the potential energy U by V is simply sigma E by 2, stress into strain divided by 2, potential energy density. Everybody understood? Type it. Go through it once, there is no hurry. Go through it and tell me, have you understood how we get the potential energy stored in it? It acts like a spring, you know. Spring can store potential energy. Same way the rod is also like acting like a spring only. So even that will have potential energy. So whatever work is done to stretch it will be stored as a potential energy. So we have found out the work done. And then just modified, played around with the variables to write it in terms of stress and strain. All of you type it. Have you understood? Go through it. No hurries. Take your time. I'll wait for a minute. Go through and let me know if you have any doubts. You know, this chapter, 99% of it is simple and straightforward, but there are few things which are tricky. Okay, it is not like a laws of motion chapter where many questions are tricky. So you just need to learn a couple of tricky questions and then you are done with the chapter. It is true for any object. This formula, stress into strain by 2, although you have derived it for rod, but because you have derived this energy density in terms of stress and strain, and that has nothing to do with dimensions of the rod, this is true for any place on the bigger object. If there is a point on which there is a stress and there's a strain, the density of potential energy at that point is stress into strain by 2. Namrata, are you able to follow? Kaushik? Kaushik, Namrata, Rishabh, type it. Is it clear? Okay. Swaraj? Clear, Swaraj? Okay. All right, guys, so we will take a break now and we will meet beyond that. So right now it is 4:08. After 15 minutes we will meet, then it will be 4:23 p.m. Little bit of chapter is remaining. The chapter will get over today itself. This is your break time. Okay, come back. All right. Am I audible? Can you hear me? Okay. Fine. So let's take some more numericals, one or two more numericals, see what all different kinds of questions can come. All right. So here is one more numerical, all of you. You have a rod like this. Rod of mass M and length L. The mass is uniformly distributed over it. It is a uniform rod of mass M and length L hanging like this. Okay. So it will stretch due to its own weight. Are you getting it? You need to find out elongation. Due to its own weight, total elongation. Okay, Young's modulus is Y. Try this, all of you. I'll give you hints. One hint I'll give you. Where do you think, first of all, tension force, no, that is a wrong answer. Whoever have answered just now, that is a wrong answer, okay? So listen to here. The stress is because of tension, the stress is, all right? Tension force is a restoring force. Tension force creates stress. Now, when you hang yourself, let's say you're hanging from your hands like that, where do you think stress is maximum, on your hands or on your feet? Where it is more, hand or feet? Just imagine you're hanging your hands. Hand it is more, palm it is maximum. So stress is changing. Stress is not constant, right? Stress is different at different positions. At the bottom most, the stress is zero. Okay? Stress is zero at the bottom most point over here. Getting it? So the hint is that you need to assume a dx element over here. This is dx at a distance of x from below. You're considering dx, all right? On this length, on dx, what is the elongation? That you have to find out. Elongation of dx. Let's call it as dl. How much is that? Try doing it. If you can understand yourself, it will be way better than I directly writing it here. Do it. Okay, Aditya got something. Others? What is the tension at a distance x away from the bottom? Did you get that? Tension? How much it is? Okay, Madhav got it. Others? You can just take the x length. Don't you think that this force on the top, whatever it feels, this is a tension that dx also feels? Do you agree with that? This is a tension dx also feels. This tension is applied by dx. Dx also applies the same tension back. So this tension is how much? This is length x. How much is the mass of this length x? Total length L has mass m. So x length will have what mass this has? M by L into x, right? So m by L into x into g is the force. Any other force on this x length? Can you answer? Any other force other than these two? Can you think of any other force? Everyone? No other force? And it is at rest, right? So m by L x g is equal to zero. So tension is equal to m by L g times x. Okay, I think cross section area should be given. So cross section area is A, let's say. Okay. Now, if this is the tension, stress is how much? Stress is T divided by area of cross section A. So it will be mg by al times x. Everyone is clear till now? Type it quick. Till now, is it, everyone is fine till now? Whatever we have done. Okay, great. So we know that stress by strain is Young's modulus. So strain is, so the strain is sigma divided by Young's modulus. So mg by a y l times x. This is my epsilon. Epsilon is what? Epsilon is the strain on dx. Okay, change in dx is dl. So that is dl divided by dx. Dx is a length, delta L by L. Delta L is dl, L is dx. Mg by a y l x. So change in dx, which is dl, is equal to mg by a y l x dx. And now you integrate it. DL will, if you integrate DL, which is change in DX, you'll get net change, total change, 0 to delta L. This will go, X will go from 0 to total length L. All right. So the answer, delta L, you'll get it as mg L. L square will come in numerator. There is L in the denominator also. One of the L will get cancelled away. MgL by 2ay. This is the change in length that will happen in a rod due to its own weight. Okay. Anyone has any doubt, quickly type in, else I will go to the next question. No doubts? All right, let's take up another one. The next question is similar to the previous question. The kind of calculus involved is similar. Okay, so just make sure that you understand the scenario. properly, you will get the answer. Okay. It's a repeat of previous question, you can say. There is a rod lying horizontally. Okay. There is a force F1 from this side and force F2 from that side. Okay. F1 is more than F2. Area of cross section is A. Young's modulus is Y. The length of the rod is L. Got it? You need to find the extension in the rod because of these two forces. Till now, our cases were two equal and opposite forces. Now they are not equal forces. Got it? So your tension you have to find out. Mass you consider as M. Very similar way, the way we have done the previous question, very similar way you have to do this also. These are the advanced level questions. So I have to tell you all the types of questions. So that is why we are doing this. Is anyone close to the answer or you're stuck? Find out the tension at a distance X. Process is very, very similar. Will the rod be at rest or it'll accelerate? Rod will have acceleration also now. Isn't it? After this question, we'll get into other theory also. Only this question is difficult. Difficult as in tricky. It's not very difficult also. Should I do it now? Nobody is able to get it? No one? Okay. We'll wait for a minute. Let's see. See, whatever you can, just do it. Whatever you can. You may get it right or wrong. It doesn't matter. Okay. Do it yourself. Okay, let us say acceleration is this way. Pranav, are you getting anything? Okay. Fine. So I can say F1 minus F2 is equal to mass times acceleration. I can say that. So acceleration, I'll get it as F1 minus F2 divided by M. Can you tell me what is the tension over here at this point? Try it, all of you. If you draw the free body diagram of only X, this is F1. Let's say this is T. The mass of this block is M by L into X. Tell me what is the tension, all of you? How will you get this? Will the acceleration of this be same as this one or not? This piece will also accelerate, same acceleration. So you will have F1 minus T is a net force on that piece is equal to mass of that piece M by L into X into acceleration F1 minus F2 by M. Okay, so M and M get cancelled. So T is equal to F1 minus F2 by L times X. This is your T, tension over there. Now everything is same. Okay, so T divided by area of cross section is stress divided by strain, which is DL by DX, is Young's modulus. Okay, so yeah, it becomes slightly messy. But only these kind of questions will differentiate topper from others. Okay, so if you're aiming to do extremely well, you must be familiar with all of this. This is this divided by the Young's modulus into dx is equal to dl. So if you rearrange it and then you just integrate it, open the brackets, integrate 0 to delta l, this will be from 0 to L. Should we consider the other side? The other side also same tension you'll get. You'll not get anything different. Mass will then be M by L into L minus X, not into X. Net force is not 0. Net force is not 0. Net force is equal to mass M acceleration. So you need to find tension, not the force which you are applying. That is not equal to the restoring force. You get the same thing. Do it yourself, you'll get it. So after the class, if you're getting something different, put it on the group, we'll discuss it. Okay, but right now, whatever we have done here, everyone go through it and let me know if you have any doubts. No doubts. Shashwat is written na F1 is greater than F2. But it does not matter. You can assume it to be this way. The answer won't change. Okay, this is how it will be in J advanced. Okay, I think. Okay, we'll not take these kind of questions, too many of them. Fine, there is one small thing that is there in our syllabus. Yeah, but then dx mass is negligible. Mass is negligible, Aditya. So there is one small thing, write down experiment to determine Young's modulus. Now, entire chapter is straightforward. Only these couple of questions I wanted to showcase so that you don't take it very lightly. So it's a simple experiment to determine the Young's modulus, and it is like this, all of you. You have a situation like this. Everyone. See, earlier, both the wires are of same cross-section area, same material, same length. But what you're doing is you're putting a mass on the second wire, and you know exactly how much mass you're putting, because of which the second wire length increases. And you have a scale over here, all right, and a pointer which was here earlier, but because the length of the wire has been changed, the pointer has moved down. Okay. The pointer is moving down because the length of the wire is changed. So earlier the pointer was here. Okay. So using the pointer, you can find out what is the change in length, right? Earlier it was here. Now it is here. So you can find out what is the change in length. Keep the pointer very close to the end of the rod. Fine, but then you have to keep very large amount of mass, otherwise you'll not notice any change in length. It'll be very, very small. Okay, so keep a very thin wire if you keep, and a large mass you keep, then you'll see substantial change in length. Okay, that is delta L. Fine, length of the rod was L, so this will give you strain. Okay, and suppose you are putting mass M over here. Stress will be how much, everyone? Sigma will be what? What should I write sigma as? Yes, Madhav got it. Others, you don't know? Madhav is in class 10th. You know that? He is answering. What happened to others? What is sigma if I keep mass M over here? Everyone should answer. Waiting for you. Else I have to take your names. Akash is not even speaking single word. I don't know what he's doing. No, you're there, here, doesn't matter, Akash. You don't even speak a thing. So being there doesn't mean anything. Abhinav, you have to start talking. And these are all personal discussion. You can send a message, only I can see it. I don't know why you have to feel shy. What is the answer here? Pranav, what it is? Pooja, Nikhil, Kaushik, Karthik. I'm waiting for your answer. Nonsense. I have to take your names. Everyone. Akash, what is your answer? I want answer from you. You are not listening. That is why you don't know. Okay. Just being in a class, you're wasting your time, my time. Mg by A. Whatever mass you're putting there, the weight of that, right, is Mg. Mg by A is a stress. Okay. Strain is this, stress is that, everything you have measured. So the Young's modulus is stress by strain, right? So you can utilize this. It is Mg by A, epsilon is delta L by L. So using this simple experiment, you can get the value of Young's modulus. Okay. Fine. So this entire discussion was related to the longitudinal stress and longitudinal strain. Fine. Now we are getting into a different kind of stress. Okay. There is another way you can deform a solid, and this kind of stress is called shear stress. Okay. So like what I have told you already, that if you can apply a force parallel to the surface, then there will be a shear displacement. So first write down shear modulus. Okay, suppose you have this kind of thing. All of you draw with me. This, okay, your base is fixed, that you can't move, and you are applying a force parallel to the surface like this. Okay, this is how you are applying force F. Fine. What will happen is the face will get displaced. Let me use another color there. This one. Face will be displaced. All of you draw with me, everyone. Okay, so this is the kind of deformation that will be seen over here. Okay. So now let's say this is theta. Getting it? So this displacement, the face, let's say, get displaced by a distance of x. All right. That is your, it is like delta L. Right, when you apply the Young's modulus and the longitudinal stress is there, delta L is there, right? Here X is there instead of delta L. And this length L is that one. Area is, let's say, A of the top surface. Okay, so the cause is shear stress. Cause of the deformation is shear stress. This is sigma s, which is parallel component of the force divided by the area. This is sigma s. Got it? Now, this is the stress. How do you think strain will be defined here? Strain is shear strain. How do you think it should be defined here? In case of longitudinal, it was delta L by L. Here, what do you think it will be? Can I say X is a strain? Will it make sense keeping X? This area I told you, right? That is the area. Area which is parallel to the force. Everyone tell, what should I write strain as? In case of longitudinal, it was delta L by L. So what it will be here, everyone? It can be X by L, right? Why it cannot be X? First answer me that. Why the effect cannot be X? Tell me that. Does X depends on L? More length will give higher X, right? That is the reason why it is better to have effect as X by L. X by L can be taken as the X by L can be taken as tan theta, where theta is this angle. This line makes, the edge makes from the initial position, and angle is very small. So this is roughly equal to theta only. Got it? Angle is very small. So tan theta and sine theta both are almost equal to theta itself. Got it? So there is something called shear modulus and modulus of rigidity. Both are same. Modulus of rigidity or shear modulus, G, is sigma S by epsilon S. Just like Young's modulus, you have shear modulus. The name is modulus of rigidity also. We'll discuss why it is that way. This is your modulus of rigidity. Okay? And this is roughly modulus of rigidity roughly equal to y by 3. Young's modulus of same material divided by 3 will be the shear modulus. Can you tell me what does it mean? What is the meaning of this? If shear modulus of the same material is very less compared to the Young's modulus, it implies what? What is the physical meaning of this? What is the effect of this? Anyone? Easier to deform. It is easier to deform using shear. A solid can be deformed very easily if there is a shear force acting on it. Okay, three times easier. Can you give me an example where this is seen? Just one example where it is seen. Anyone? No one? Ajay, you might have seen piece of paper. If I stretch it like this, then it is easy to break. Or if I do it like this, then it is easy. It is easy that way, right? This is shear. Okay. And when you are using scissor, scissor offers the shear stress or the longitudinal stress. What do you think? When you use scissor to cut, it is shear or longitudinal? It doesn't compresses. It does like this. Okay. It is a shear force using scissor. So using scissor, it is very easy to cut. And your knife, when you're cutting potato, the force you apply is parallel to the cross section which comes after the cutting it, right? So if you use knife, it is easy to chop the potato. But if you stretch the potato like this, if you apply longitudinal force, will it be easier that way? No. So there are a lot of examples. The earthquake that comes, earthquake shakes the ground like this. This kind of load is shear, which is very difficult for the buildings to take. So that is why many of them collapse. Fine. So that's the reason why understanding shear is the most important thing if you're talking about any failure in the solid. Because if you take care of shear, the longitudinal automatically takes care of it. Because 1/3 of the longitudinal is shear. Getting it? Okay. Let's take a question from your book. Okay. Even our bones, you know, this guy, look at this guy. Don't know why he's doing all that. Look at this crazy guy. This guy is holding on his two legs. He's holding person one, person two, person three, and there are a lot of tables and chair, which is equivalent to another person. So effectively on his two legs, there's a load of four people, around 400 kgs. So your bones also have a shear modulus. So you, the Young's modulus. So the bones will get compressed. And if it get compressed beyond the yield point, it'll not be able to regain. Permanent deformation can happen. Okay. So yeah, crazy fellow. But then they have a lot of practice. So they do it for the living. I'll give the Young's modulus here. Sorry, the shear modulus here. It is 5.6 into 10 raised to power 9 Newton per meter square. Do it. First thing is draw the diagram. Drawn the diagram. Okay, Aditya got something. Others? No, Aditya, check your calculations. Akash. Others? Okay, I'll do it now, everyone. So square lead of side 50 centimeter. So this side is square 50 centimeter. Okay, the thickness is 10 centimeter. This thickness is 10 centimeter. Okay, shearing force on the narrow face. So where is the shearing force in the diagram? All of you, where is the shearing force in the diagram? This is the lead slab. On it, where is the shearing force? It is like this. Okay, the bottom is fixed. This is fixed. This is a shearing force F. Okay, so which area you have to take? Area of this you have to take, isn't it? So the area which you should take is 50 into 10 centimeter square. This area you should take. Fine. Then so the stress is sigma s is the force which you are applying, 9 into 10 is power 4 divided by area, that is 500, 50 into 10 centimeter square. So that you have to multiply by 10 is power minus 4 to convert in meter square. Okay, so 9 by 5 into 10 is power 6 newton per meter square. This is your stress, and stress by strain is your modulus of rigidity. So strain, which is x by l, will give you sigma s by modulus of rigidity g. G is this, so from here x will be equal to this. Everybody understood? This is l. From this is your l, right? Clear to everyone? You done it like this? Those who got the wrong answer, Himanshu, have you seen it? Aditya? Okay. All right, calculation error. Don't do that. It is very, very, it'll create a big trouble. Calculation errors. Okay. All right. So the last type of deformation is the one in which you're compressing the object from all sides. Okay. That has to do with bulk modulus. The name is bulk modulus. Okay. Now, bulk modulus is a situation in which there is pressure from all sides that is compressing the object. when you compress the object, will the volume decrease or not? Overall volume will decrease. Everyone agree? Will density decrease or increase? If volume is decreasing, what happens to the density? Density increases. Very good. Okay. So over here, the volumetric stress, it is called volumetric stress. Okay. Volumetric stress. It is nothing but delta P only. Okay, this is a volumetric stress. Okay, and the strain, what do you think strain will be? Everyone, volumetric strain. Any guesses? Everyone, what it will be? Change in volume delta V by V. Now tell me, delta V is a positive quantity or negative quantity? Delta V is a positive or negative quantity? Everyone. Delta V is what? Final volume minus initial volume. Delta of anything, any variable, is final minus initial. So it's a negative quantity. Strain, negative strain doesn't mean anything. Negative deformation, what does it mean? Deformation is deformation, right? So you put a minus sign here to make deformation positive. So minus delta V by V you have to write. Okay. So the bulk modulus B is written as delta P divided by minus of delta V by V. Okay. It can be written as minus of V delta P by delta V. Okay. And in a differential form, it can be written as minus V dP by dV. That way also you can write. Okay. So this is the definition of the bulk modulus. All right. Everybody clear about it? Can pressure be pulling the object, expanding it? Yeah, yeah, it can expand also, but the common scenario is this only, compression. So we'll be talking about this only. Expansion, you know, no, it doesn't happen. I mean, very, very rarely. It has to be hollow, first of all. It can't be solid. Inside, the gas is there, it expands. So hypothetical scenario you have to generate. Okay. All right. So all of you, listen here. We know that things can get compressed, right? Volume can change. Mass is density into volume. Okay. If you differentiate mass with respect to x, you know the chain rule, right? Dm by dx, x is any variable. It'll be rho. You know this or not, everyone? Chain rule, you're aware of it? Everyone, chain rule. Okay. So you can cancel out dx. What is dm? DM is what? Any guesses? What is the value of DM? Change in mass in compression. DM. What it is? Will mass change? When you compress it, will mass change? DM will be zero. It will be zero. Okay. So rho dV is equal to minus of V d rho. So from here, you get a very important relation. dv by v minus of dv by v is equal to d rho by rho. Okay, so you can write your volumetric strain, which is d delta v by v. Delta v by v is roughly equal to delta rho by rho also. So in terms of density also you can write. Okay, chain rule we have done in the bridge program, right? Now let's look back at it again. In the bulk modulus, did we make an, yes, approximation we have made. The approximation is change in volume is very less. And that is fine. That is a reasonable assumption. You can't compress a piece of steel from 2 meter cube to 1 meter cube, right? Very small change only will happen. Okay. Whatever your doubt is, directly type in. Don't say I have a doubt, then I'll ask you what is your doubt. B is equal to minus V delta P by delta V. Okay. Now here, this expression in the numerator is delta P the total pressure or the extra pressure? What do you think? Total pressure or change in pressure? Everyone, what do you think? Delta P is total or extra pressure? It is the extra pressure. Okay. It is a change in pressure. Fine. Okay. And what is the common scenario, most common scenario wherein you will get a change in pressure? You have done the fluids, right? When you go inside the fluid of density rho, let's say you go by a distance of h, what will be the change in pressure? From here to here at a depth of h, density is rho, delta P will be? Delta P will be equal to rho gh. And what will be the total pressure over there? Total pressure is what? P naught plus rho gh, atmospheric pressure plus rho gh. Okay, but then in the formula you have to write delta P only. Okay, water can exert tremendous amount of pressure. Okay, it is, you can't believe kind of pressure water can exert. In fact, there the professional divers, they can't go beyond couple of meters inside the sea. Otherwise water will compress their chest from all sides, they won't be able to breathe. They have oxygen cylinders and everything, but they can't expand the lungs and take oxygen in. So they will be dying, right? In fact, the kind of machines that are made, submarine, for example, I don't know whether you guys know it, there was an accident in Russian submarine because of some loss of fuel or something. It got submerged couple of kilometers down below the sea. And at that level, the compression delta P is so big that the entire submarine got crushed. Okay, because you can't maintain high pressure inside submarine. So inside submarine, it is lesser pressure because humans are there. Outside pressure is very large. So it compresses it. And when submarine will get compressed, screws, bolts and everything will just fire like bullets and it'll get totally crushed. Okay, so it and these guys were maintaining the communication from outside world. They could talk to them and everything, but nobody can come and save them because pressure is so high. No one can go inside and save them. Okay, so that is, it is a very, very important parameter, the change in pressure inside the water. Okay, in fact there is a question in our textbook. Let's attempt that. Isn't VdP is equal to PdV? What? What are you asking, Pranav? This is the thing. Okay, so I ignore your doubts then. All right, so let's take the question which I was talking about. Do this. Look at the average depth of Indian Ocean, and that is the true value. It's not a false value. 3 kilometers below. Find out. Density of the water, you can take 1,000. What is the answer, everyone? Okay, Aditya got something. Pooja, Swaraj, Pranav. Can't be minus 70. It's very, very large. Okay. This is what happens, Pranav. You take things for granted. You assume that simple questions, I'll not pay that much attention. You'll get those questions wrong, which lakhs of students will get it right. Okay, imagine the kind of damage. All right, so here, everyone, delta P. You have to find out first, which is rho GH. Rho is 10 to the power 3. G, you can take it as 10. H is 3 into 10 raised to the power 3. So delta P is sorted. 3 into 10 raised to the power 7 Newton per meter square. You know what is the atmospheric pressure roughly? What it is? Atmospheric pressure is roughly 10 raised to the power 5 Newton per meter square. So we are talking about 300 times more pressure than the atmospheric pressure below the sea. One atmospheric pressure itself is very large. We're talking 300 times more than that. Anyway, so this is delta P. The bulk modulus is given. Bulk modulus is delta P divided by delta V by V. Okay, so minus sign is there, but I'm ignoring minus sign because I know it is compression. So delta V by V is delta P, which is 3 into 10 raised to the power 7 divided by the bulk modulus, which is 2.2 into 10 raised to the power 9. So this is roughly, you can say 1.39 or 1.4, whatever, into 10 raised to the power minus 2. Okay, in terms of percentage, 1.39% change or 1.39% of the compression is there. Fine. So volume will decrease by this much percentage. Density will increase by the same percentage. Delta V by Y, V is equal to delta rho by rho. This is also equal to delta rho by rho. We have proved it. Everyone clear? Everyone clear? This was the last piece of the kind of deformation which we are studying here. Okay. Anyone has any doubt in this? Okay. Clear. So just a small thing left over in the chapter. It'll take just 2 minutes. Then this chapter will be over. So we are talking about application of the oxygen cylinder also blast if we go very deep. No, Shashwat, simple experiment. You have a, let's say, a plastic bottle. Okay. It will not get crushed because of the atmospheric pressure, because inside the bottle air is there. But if you suck the air out from the plastic bottle, will it get crushed or not? If you suck air out of a plastic bottle, will it get crushed? Same way. Oxygen cylinder won't get crushed because inside oxygen is already there at high pressure. Okay. But then yes, if oxygen pressure inside the oxygen cylinder is lesser and outside pressure is high, then oxygen cylinder will get crushed. Okay. And there's a high chance that will happen because 300 atmosphere, I don't think that much pressure will be there in oxygen cylinder. So if you go very deep down, then even oxygen cylinder can get crushed. Okay. We are talking about great depths here. Write down application of and in inside submarine, you cannot afford to have higher pressure. The moment you increase it to like 5 or 6 atmosphere inside the submarine, then you will not be able to breathe. Okay, lungs won't be able to expand because from outside pressure is very high. You have to maintain low pressure inside the submarine. Similarly, in the aircraft, you have to maintain higher pressure inside because outside pressure is very less. Okay. So in the movies, you might have seen whenever some, let's say a small hole is also there or door is open in the aircraft, which is in the air, outside pressure is very less. Inside it is very high. So it is like vacuum outside, which will try to suck whatever is there inside the aircraft. So everybody will fall, throw outwards. That you might have seen in movies. If you see movies, behavior of material. Very, very briefly, they have been discussing about all of that. We have discussed that already, in fact. Suppose, talk about a bridge. You see, bridge has this kind of design. You've seen this kind of design? For the bridges, topmost portion will have higher area or not? Topmost portion where the load is there, the area is big. So that force per unit area is smaller there. If you increase area, force per unit area will be lesser. And why not keep it like this? What is the problem in keeping like this straight? Any guesses? Why not like that? To save the money. Yeah, save the cost, right? You using this material, you can create another this thing, all right? So you have already decreased the stress. You don't need to make so, you know, strong like that. So that's the reason, simple reason, wastage of material. And have you seen I-beams? Have you seen I-beams? I-beams are very popular. Have you seen it? This kind. It can break in the middle, but it can with a single, if you take like this, it will break much faster than an object like this. This will withstand tremendous amount of load. This can't. Even though amount of material is similar, you just have to increase little bit area here. Huh? This I-beam, where have you seen? Posters. Where else have you seen? Anywhere else? Have you seen railway tracks? Railway tracks, they're I-beams only. Okay? They can also withstand large amount of pressure without crumbling down. Okay, because this area is larger. Okay, so different applications are there, and there is one little formula that is given in your curriculum is this one. Suppose you take a beam like this, okay, and you hang a weight in the middle. You hang a weight in the middle. What will happen to the beam? Beam will bend. Beam will bend, let's say bends by an amount of delta. Let's say this is delta. You want this delta to be less or more? Less. You don't want deformation in your solids, right? So the expression for the delta is W. W is a weight into L cube divided by 4B D cube into Young's modulus. This is an empirical relation. Proof of this is not in your curriculum. L is the length. L is the length. This is D. Okay. D is the width. And B is the depth. Okay. So you can see here, if you want your deformation delta to be lesser, what you can do is you can keep the length same. You can increase the depth. You can increase the depth, or you can increase the D. Increasing D will help lot more, because this is D cube in the denominator, right? So this, using this relation, there might be one or two numericals here and there in your school. Okay. So that is all about the chapter, guys. And I hope you are now very clear about it. This chapter is a simple chapter, very simple. Okay. What is depth? Depth is inside, right? There will be, it is not a two-dimensional thing, Aditya. It is a three-dimensional thing. There will be one dimension going into your screen, right? A rod has width. So width and depth both. So yes, so what I was saying was, whatever varieties of numericals that exist, more or less everything we have done today itself. Okay, it is not like Newton's laws of motion, wherein different varieties, thousands of different varieties of questions are there. Here, varieties of questions are very few. Whatever difficult type of varieties are there, I have already done it with you guys. Okay, so all you have to do is get to know these difficult kinds and be comfortable with them. And this chapter is over at all levels. School level, JEE Mains level, JEE Advanced level, NEET level, whatever level you're aiming at, do not leave this chapter at all. Because this chapter ensures that if a question comes, and you have done a little bit of practice, you will get full marks. So do not think of leaving it. And I'm going to give you assignment. Make sure you do it and finish it off in this week itself so that you never have to look back at this chapter for next 2 years. Okay. And this chapter will be solid if you do the assignments immediately after class, maybe after 1 or 2 days. Okay. So that's it, guys, from my side. And we will meet next week. We will start mechanical properties of fluid. That is a big chapter. It'll take 3 to 4 classes to complete that. Bye for now. Rigid body dynamics will take later. First, I have to catch up your school.